Welcome to e-lecture series for BTech 4SEM subject data communication and computer networks. Myself Prakash Meena, assistant professor computer science and engineering college Ajmer. So today's topic is link state routing. So link state routing. So as we know that distance vector routing was used in the ARPANET. So when it was replaced by link state routing, the primary problem that caused its demise was until 1979 the distance vector routing is used, and after that link state routing replaced it. And the problem that caused its demise was that the algorithm often took too long to converge after the network topology changed. So we know about the count to infinity problem, and it was replaced by an entirely new algorithm called as link state routing, and a variant of link state routing called IS-IS and OSPF are the routing algorithms that are most widely used inside large networks and the internet today. And idea behind link state routing is fairly simple and can be stated as 5 parts. So here you can see the 5 parts, and each router must do the following things to make it work. So first, discover the neighbors and learn their network addresses. Second, set the distance or cost metric to each of its neighbors. Third, construct a packet telling all it has just learned. And fourth, send this packet to and receive packets from all other routers, and compute that shortest path to every other router. So the complete topology is distributed to every router, and then Dijkstra's algorithms can be run at each router to find the shortest path to every other router. So let's start with first learning about the neighbors. So when a router is booted, its first task is to learn who its neighbors are, and it accomplish this goal by sending a special hello packet on each point-to-point line. And the router on the other end is expected to send back to reply giving its name. This name must be globally unique, because when a distance router later hears that 3 routers are all connected to F, it is essential that it can determine whether all 3 mean the same F. So here you can see also in figure. And when 2 or more routers are connected by a broadcast link such as switch, ring or classic Ethernet, the situation is slightly more complicated. And here you can see in figure 5A, a broadcast LAN to which 3 router ACF are directly connected, and each of these routers is connected to one or more additional routers. You can see here. And the broadcast LAN provides connectivity between each pair of attached routers. However, modeling the LAN as many point-to-point links increases the size of the topology and leads to a wasteful messages. A better way to model the LAN is to consider it as a node itself, as you can see in figure B. And here we have introduced a new artificial node and to which A, C and F are connected. So one designated router on the LAN is selected to play the role of N in the routing protocol, and the fact that it is possible to go from A to C on the LAN is represented by a path A and C here. Then next, setting link cost. The link state routing algorithm requires each link to have a distance or cost metric for finding shortest path. The cost to reach neighbors can be set automatically or configured by the network operator, and a common choice is to make the cost inversely proportional to the bandwidth of the link. So for example, a 1 Gbps Ethernet may have a cost of 1 and 100 Mbps Ethernet a cost of 10, and this makes higher capacity path better choices. And if the network is geographically spread out, the delay of the links may be factored into the cost, so that path over the shorter links are better choices. The most direct way to determine this delay is to send over the line a special eco packets that the other side is required to send back immediately. And by measuring the round trip time and dividing it by 2, the sending routers can get a reasonable estimate of the delay. The next is building link state packets. Once the information needed for the exchange has been collected, the next step is for each router to build a packet containing all the data, and the packet start with the identity of the sender and followed by sequence number and age and a list of neighbors. The cost to each neighbor is also given, and an example network is here, you can see in figure. And with a figure A network with cost shows shown as label on the lines, and the corresponding link state packets for each for all six routers are shown here in figure B. So you can see the link state predicates for the given network. And the building the link state packet is easy. The hard part is determining when to build them, and once possibility is to build them periodically, that is the at regular intervals, and another possibility is to build them when some significant event occurs, such as a line or neighbors going down or coming back up again or changing its property appreciably. And then next is distributing the link state packets. So trickiest part of the algorithm is distributing the link state packets. All of the routers must go must get all of the link state packets quickly and reliably. And if different routers are using different versions of the topology, the routers then computers can have inconsistencies such as loops, unreachable machines and other problems. So first we will describe the basic distribution algorithm. After that we will give some refinements. So the fundamental idea is to give flooding to distribute the link state packets to all routers and to keep the flood in check, and each packet contains a sequence number that is incremented for each new packet sent, and routers keep the track of all the source router sequence pairs they have or they see, and when a new link state packets come in, it is checked against the list of packets already seen, and if it is new, it is forwarded on all lines except the one it arrived on, and if it is a duplicate, it is discarded. If a packet with sequence number lower than the highest one seen, so for your arrives, and it is rejected as being obsolete as the router has more recent data. So this algorithm has a few problems, but they are manageable. And first, if the sequence numbers wrap around, confusion will reign. And the solution here is to use a 32-bit sequence number, and with one link state packet per second, it would take 137 years to wrap around. So this possibility can be ignored. And second, if a router ever crashes, it will lose track of its sequence number. If it start again at zero, the next packet it sends will be rejected as a duplicate. And third, if a sequence number is ever corrupted and 65,540 is received instead of 4, a 1-bit error, or packets 5 through 65,540 will be rejected as obsolete. And since the current sequence number will be thought to be 65,540, so the solution to all these problems is to include the age of each packet after the sequence number and decrement it once per second. When the age hits zero, the information from the router is discarded, and normally a new packet comes in and every 10 seconds. So router information only times out when a router is down, and the age field is also decremented by each router during the initial flooding process to make sure no packet can get lost and leave for an indefinite period of time. And some refinement to this algorithm make it more robust. When a link state packets come into a router for flooding, it is not queued for transmission immediately. Instead, it is put in a holding area to wait a short while in case more links are coming up or going down. If another link state packet from the same source comes in before the first packet is transmitted, their sequence numbers are compared, and if they are equal, the duplicate is discarded. So if they are different, the older one is thrown out. And to guard against error on the links, and all link state packets are acknowledged. So the data structure used by router B for the network shown as your figure, you can see. So here is your figure, and here is the packet buffer for router B, and is depicted here. So each row here correspond to a recently arrived but as yet not fully processed and link state packet. So the table records where the packet originated, its sequence number and age and the data, and in addition there are sends and acknowledgement flags for each of B's three links to A, C, F respectively. So here you can see A, C, F, and the send flags mean that the packet must be sent on the indicated link, and the acknowledgement flag means that it must be acknowledged there. So the link state packet from A arrived directly, so it must be sent to CF and acknowledged to A as indicated by the flag bits, and similarly the packet from F has to be forwarded to A and C and acknowledged to F. So here you can see. The situation with the third packet from E is different. It arrives twice, once via EAB or once via EFB, and it has to be sent only to C but must be acknowledged to both A and F as indicated by the bits. And if a duplicate packet arrives while the original is still in the buffer, bits have to be changed. So for example, if a copy of C states arrive from F before the fourth entry in the table has been forwarded, the six bits would be changed to 100011 to indicate that the packet must be acknowledged to F but not sent there. Then the next is computing the new route. So once a router has accumulated a full set of link state packet, it can construct the entire network graph, because every link is represented. Every link is in fact represented twice, once for each direction, and the different direction may even have different cost. The shortest path computation may then find different paths from router A to B, then from router B to A. So now discuss algorithm can be run locally to construct the shortest path in all possible destination, and the result of this algorithm tell the router which link to use to reach each destination, and this information is installed in the routing table and normal operation is resumed. So compared to distance vector routing, link state routing requires more memory and computation, and for a network with n router, each of which has k neighbors, and the memory required to store the input data is proportional to kn, and which is at least at large as routing table listing all the destination, and also the computation times grows faster than kn, and even with the most efficient data structure, an issue is large networks. And in many practical situations, link state routing works well because it does not suffer from slow convergence problems. And also link state routing is widely used in actual networks. So there is a example protocol here, and many ISP uses ISIS, intermediate system link state protocol, and it was designed for an early network called DEC net, and later adapted by ISO for use with the OSI protocol, and then modified to handle other protocols as well. Then next is IP OSPF, open shortest path first, is the other main link state protocol. It was designed by IETF several years after ISIS and adopted many of the innovations designed for ISIS. and this innovation scheduled a self-stabilizing method of flooding link state updates and the concept of a designated router on a LAN and the method of computing and supporting path splitting and multiple matrices. And there is very little difference between ISIS and OSPF. The most important difference is that ISIS can carry information about multiple network layers protocol at the same time, such as IP, IPX and AppleTalk, and OSPF does not have this feature. It is an advantage in large multi-protocol environments. So that's all about link state routing algorithm. So the session ends here. Thank you. And one more thing, all the matters and materials diagram from Computer Network 5th edition. So you can refer this book for more information about link state routing algorithms. Now the session ends here. Thank you.